Lecture. Starting recording. So today we are going to move to, we're going to slowly depart from the graph minor structure and like true if and grids that we had previously. So we start, we'll say something about true if later during the lecture, but at this moment we won't do almost anything about the true if. We'll be doing something different. We'll spend like first part of the lecture, I'm studying something called well quasi-orders. Actually, this hyphen should be in here. I don't know why it's there. Well quasi-orders. And then we'll do something called Kruskal's theorem, which is saying that read trees with something called topological minor relation is well quasi-ordered. But yeah, let's just go to the definitions. This is like the second ingredient we need to really understand the main things in the graph minor theory. Okay, so a quasi-order is, you just need to think about it as a partial order ring. I mean, that's, there's no big difference. You don't have any loss in like combinatorics of the problem if you think just about partial orders, but the quasi-order is like a partial order when you can have a number of different elements that are sort of equal. You treat them as equal ones, but they're like technically speaking different elements. So a quasi-order technically is just a reflexive and transitive relation. So just like you usually think of this as an equality, so x is always not larger than x, and also you have got that if x is smaller than y and y is smaller than or not larger than z, then x is larger smaller than z. Yeah, so we have got transitivity and regressive, but you don't have this that if something is, if x is smaller than y and y is smaller than x, then they're actually the same guys. Okay, you don't have this. You don't have this, so you can have, technically speaking, a few arbitrary equal guys in your set that you're comparing, and and this is like, this is really like a technical thing. I mean, this only says that there's like, instead of one guy, there's like a blob of equivalent guys, and it's easy to speak about this in terms of graphs, so that you can have got a few isomorphic graphs that are essentially equal, but they're not technically equal if you think about it as a set theory objects. They have got different elements as vertices or something like that. So it's easier on like formal level to speak about quasi-orders and orders when we think about relations like being a subgraph of a graph or being a subdivision of a graph or being a minor of a graph. It's easier to discuss things of it as a quasi-order, not an order, but there's really no combinatorics loss if you think about orders and just think of all isomorphic graphs as just one graph. Okay, good. So now if we look at the well quasi-order is a quasi-order where you, in every, the formal definition is as follows. In every sequence, you have got later some element that's larger than the previous one. So there's, if you have got some elements, you can pick two guys in the sequence such that the earlier one is not larger than the later one. They may be equal. Okay, they may be equal, but so this is the formal definition. We'll play with it for a while during this lecture. So we'll familiarize it. But let's look at a few examples to start from. First, the natural numbers with comparison, positive numbers or non-negative numbers with comparison. This is an excellent example. If you have any sequence of natural numbers, at some moment there will be like a repetition or later element will be larger than the earlier one. You cannot like go down in the sequence intuitively here, okay? Also, if you can think about it, if you have got something that's well quasi-order, like a product, a finite product of this well quasi-orders with coordinate comparison is also quite well quasi-ordered, that requires a bit more, but you can think of this, it requires a bit of a proof, but if you think about like, if you look at the tuples of, for example, of five integers and you compare it coordinate-wise, so one tuple is smaller than the other one if on every coordinate it's smaller, like not larger, then it's also well quasi-order because you need to look like coordinate by coordinate. We'd have a proof in a moment. We have got tools for the proof in a moment, but it's not very difficult to prove it, but it requires some proof here. Also, there's a nice observation that if you look at any finite, if you have any quasi-order in a finite set, it's always a well quasi-order. Because in any sequence you will have a repetition of an element, and that's enough for the non-examples, the things that are not well quasi-orders. You can look at all the integers with inequalities, with inequalities, because you can have just going numbers going down, like minus one, minus two, minus three, minus four, and there's never a larger element after a smaller element. Okay. Another nice example is like integers with divisibility relation. So like an element is, so a is smaller than b if a divides b. Okay. Yeah. Then in this example, the primes is an antigen here. Yeah. I mean, if you take it on primes, there are infinitely many primes. So if you take a sequence of all primes, there's no two that one divides the other, and you don't have any two. So there are there's infinitely many incomparable guys. Okay, so this is not the well quasi-order. Another example are graphs with being subgraph. So being a subgraph is a quasi-order, right? If a guy is smaller than is a subgraph of another guy, it's transitive. I mean, the guy is a subgraph of itself, it's reflexive, it's transitive. You're a subgraph of somebody who is a subgraph of somebody, you're a subgraph of this final guy. That's easy. But they're not well quasi-order, and there's still, again, as with divisibility is an anti-chain, let me draw one. You can look at this graph, then you can draw a graph with one vertex inside here. You can draw it the same with two vertices inside here. Oh, sorry, two vertices inside here, and make more, one, two, three, and more, etc. And this is an antigen. Yeah, no graph here is a subgraph of another graph, and yeah. So this is an example that graphs with subgraph relation is not a quasi-order. So if you think about these non-examples here, I mean, there were no antigens. Every two guys are comparable, but you had a strict decreasing sequence here. Okay. And in these two examples, there were no strict decreasing sequences, but there were like infinite antigens here as an examples. And like, so how does it, maybe this is like, I mean, a general form, like if you are not well quasi-orders, you have one of these objects there. And this is really true. Like, let's look at the following lemma, which is like basic tool that, basically it's like a basics of understanding of well quasi-orders is that, either if you are well quasi-order, you are well quasi-order if and only if in every sequence you not only have two elements such that the earlier one is smaller than the later one, but you can find an infinite non-decreasing sequence inside this sequence. Like there's not only one pair, but there's a full infinite sequence of like, you know, that's non-decreasing. Every two guys are comparable. And the other equivalent thing is that there's no infinite iteration, because there are the two counterexamples that we have on the previous things are the only two things that can badly happen. You can have an infinite antichain, and this is of course a counterexample to being quasi-order, because if you just list this antichain, you don't have any comparable guys. So this is a counterexample to being well quasi-ordered. And also if you have got a strictly decreasing sequence, this is also a counterexample to being well quasi-ordered. Okay.
What's the difference between 3 and 1?
So the definition of what quasi-order was like that. In every sequence, there is two elements that are like comparable in this direction, like the later.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. I mean, this lemma is nothing very deep. I will just prove it in a moment, but what I just said was the implication from 1 to 3. Okay. That the implication from 1 to 3 is the obvious one what I just said. I mean, if in any sequence you have a comparable pair with the smaller guy being earlier, then you cannot have an infinite antichain, because if you list it, you don't have such a pair, and you cannot have a strictly decreasing sequence, because if you write it, you don't have such a pair. Okay, so I just so this is a proof from 1 to 3. And now to understand the other equivalences here, this is just a simple Ramsey argument. Yeah, I mean, let's look at any sequence x1, x2, x3, blah, blah, blah. Okay, and now let's look at x1. And look how it compares to the later guys. I mean, with every later guy, he can either be like smaller or equal. Okay, this is like, let me use colors here. This is like the red relation. He can be smaller or equal. He can be in gray, green relation, can be strictly larger than something later. Okay, or he can be in blue relation, he can be incomparable. Like, I don't know how to write incomparable. Like, let me write C, incomparable. Okay. So with X1, with every guy later has got one of the three relations. He's either smaller or equal, or strictly larger, or incomparable. Okay, so these are like three. So we can draw these edges. So he has got some green edges, some blue edges, and some red edges. But with one color appears infinitely many times. So he is either incomparable to infinitely many later guys, or strictly larger than infinitely many later guys, or smaller or equal to infinitely many later guys. So let's choose the majority option. Let's say that, like the infinite option, say that he's incomparable with many guys, with later of infinite many guys. So let's color him blue. Okay, and let's kick out the guys that are not, let's kick out the guys that are not incomparable with him. So let's restrict the sequence and keep only the guys that are incomparable with X1. Okay, now the next guy that's left, the first guy that's left is X3, like we continue the process. And now we look what's the X3, what's the relation of X3 with the guys later, okay? He's either, they're either like red, infinitely many red edges, means that X is equal or smaller, green edges, X is strictly larger, or incomparable. So say now red wins, there are infinitely many red edges towards the remaining guys. Yeah, we only count the guys that remain in the sequence. But there are some of the guys get crossed out, and we continue this process, okay? So we select an infinite subsequence because this process continues for infinite number of steps. And we have got this property that every guy in the sequence has got like uniform relation to the later guys. Yeah, he's either always in blue, so always blue, so always incomparable, or always green, strictly larger, or always smaller or equal, okay? And this guy gets the color of this, like this choice he made. Oh, so the color choice, so he's either blue, red, or green, depending on whether he's, what's his relation to all the later guys. Okay, so we have got the infinite sequence, and now we make the last filtering step of choosing like the infinite, the color that appears infinitely many times. I mean, there may be all of them appear infinitely times, but we pick one of these colors, red, green, or blue, such that infinitely many guys were colored with this color. That means that infinitely many guys has got this relation to the later guys. Yes, so our final step. No, so non-decreasing means that there's a relation which is equal or larger. That was so non-decreasing means that it's not strictly decreasing, but there's a relation which is like the equality, like the red equality. Okay, so I mean, two guys can be, I mean, so like so non-decreasing means that a sequence y1, y2 up there is non-decreasing. If for every y smaller than j, you have got yi is, I mean, this curvy than yj. Okay, I hope that answers your question. Yes, so you have, so this means non-decreasing here. So it's like increasing or equal. I mean, we require comparability there. Okay. Okay. So this is, so you in the final filtering step, you select the color that appears infinitely many times, and you have got the subsequence, let's call it now Z, and say, I don't know, if this was a red subsequence, Z1, Z2, et cetera, a subsequence of these ones, then all of them have had red edges between them. That means that this is really a non-decreasing sequence. Like all of them are comparable, like smaller or equal to the later guys, okay? If we have infinitely many green guys, then this is Z1, which is strictly smaller than Z2, which is strictly larger than Z3, etc. So this is really a strictly decreasing sequence, okay? And if you have got a blue guy, this is like Z1 incomparable with Z2, incomparable with Z3, and all of them being incomparable. I mean, now the order doesn't really matter. We have got an infinite integer here, okay? So we really performed a simple Ramsey argument, like on countability level, that if you have got a countable clique with three colors, you have got an incountable clique of one color up there. Yeah, so we performed some simple Ramsey argument, but it shows that in every sequence, you either have got a red clique, which is a strict non-decreasing subsequence, or a green clique, which is strictly decreasing subsequence, or an infinite antigen, okay? And now, if you look at the subsequence, okay, now, if you, okay, so now if you look, if you look at three, if you cannot have infinite antichain nor an infinite strictly decreasing sequence, then the blue click cannot happen and the green click cannot happen. So you have got the implication from three to two. Yeah, if you every sequence, we just proved that every sequence has one of these three options, and 0.3 forbids green option and blue option, so there's always the red option there. There's always a non-decreasing subsequence. Okay, and of course from 2 implies 1 because it's like a strict. We get more from 2 than from 1. Yeah, 2 says that in every sequence there's a non-decreasing subsequence, and 0.1 really says that in every sequence there's 1 pair that the earlier guy is not larger than the later guy. Okay, so yeah, so implication to 2:1 is obvious. So we have proven just this simple lemma, which hopefully gives you some intuition about what quasi-orders. It just says that in this Ramsey argument below, you never can get infinite blue click nor green click. You always get infinite red click in every subsequence. This is a well quasi order. Okay, good. So I hope this is clear, because that was a good warm up to how well quasi orders work. Now on a high level, what I want to say is that all this graph minors theory, they're all developed to prove one theorem. I mean, they're useful on their own and many parts are useful on their own and we learned about them, but the main goal at some moment was the proof that the minor relation is a well quasi order. So obviously by the minor relation, you don't have infinite strictly decreasing sequences, because if you have got a strict, like something is a proper minor of another one, you always get less edges or less vertices, so you cannot have an infinite there. But the question remains whether there's an infinite anti-chain for minor. That's a very difficult question. If you think about the subgraph, we created a simple anti-chain, but minor is like a richer relation. It's easier to be a minor. So this is a really deep theorem saying that there's no infinite anti-chain in the minor relation. And as you see, it was developed over 20 years by Robertson Seymour. It was already known as Wagner's conjecture. I think Wagner claimed he never conjectured it, but somehow it was coined to Wagner's conjecture. And this is really a proof that developed the whole theory of the graph minors. There are like 23 papers out of it. So there are 23 parts of this proof, totaling to more than 500 pages. As for now, I mean, 16 years after the last thing appeared or 17 years after the last part appeared, we have got simplified a number of things. I mean, things are better understood, or at least with better bounds, or like with better understanding what's really going there, but still the proof is really large. So the plan for the lecture in a week is to give us a highlight how this proof really works. And today is really a warm up. So we are building some tools to understand how this proof really works. Okay. And also there are some tutorial exercises to understand which pictures can appear in various scenarios there. Okay. So this is like highlight of what we are going to speak about. And but let us look at one conjecture, one corollary. So if you think now, this is like quite general way of thinking, like say you have got a graph class, so a set of graphs that's closed under taking minors. So whenever you have a graph and you take a minor, it's in this graph class. A good example here, I mean, were planar graphs, or like, because if you contract an edge on a planar graph, you still have a planar graph, or bounded tree graphs. These are also minor closed, but there are a number of other minor closed graph classes which are interesting. Okay. And now you can define a graph class, the minor closed graph class, by pointing the minimal guys that are not in the graph class. Okay, so this is this way of thinking of like minimal forbidden minors. So for every graph class, you can think what are the guys that are not in the graph class, but whenever you delete an edge, delete a vertex, or contract an edge, you land in the graph class. So for example, for planar graphs, these minimal guys, there are K5, K33. Okay, so I mean, these are the planar graphs that are not planar, but whatever you contract or delete there, you get a planar graph, and these are the only guys. This is like this Kuratowski and Wagner's theorem. I mean, this is really Wagner's theorem up there, that these are the minor minimal guys that are not planar. Okay, and so these are two of them for planar graphs. And think of the minimal guys, this is always an anti-chain. Yeah, because I mean, if one is a minimal of another, the larger one shouldn't be, isn't the minimal guy. Okay, so there's always an anti-chain. And what really this theorem of Robertson-Seymour says is that this anti-chain is always finite. Okay, so you can always characterize a minor closed graph class by listing a finite number of graphs that are minimal not in the graph class. Okay, So if you have this graph class G, you can list this minimal guys F. These are minimal, not in F, not in G, okay? And now you have got a statement that your graph G is in your graph class, if and only if for every guy in H, H is not a minor of G, okay? Yeah, so you have got a statement that how do you can recognize if a graph is in a graph class, you take this finite list. I mean, there are two graphs of planar graphs, but maybe many different graph classes. And you take your graph, and if you want to check if you are in your graph class, you can, for every this forbidden minor, minimal forbidden minor, you can check if you're a minor there. And if you're not, then you know that you're in your graph class because there are all minimal guys. But if one of them is a minor, you know that you're not in your graph class because something minimal was your minor. Okay? And the graph class is minor closed. So this is really a. So this is like very interesting in the sense that you can check, or it was like we discussed what does it mean to check in a moment, but that somehow verifying if something is in a minor closed graph class is like a finite operation, that there's only a finite graph that you want to check if you're a minor there. Okay. So for planar graphs, if you want to check if a graph is planar, one way of doing it is to look if K5 is a minor there or K3 is a minor there. And because those are the only two minimal guys, minor minimal guys that are not planar, if they're not minors, you know that you're a planar even without embedding, looking for an embedding. Okay. So on top of it, I mean, I wiped out to have some space. On top of it, inside the same sequence of papers, there's actually this scraping algorithm that I want to go into details here, that checking if one is a minor can be done in time, like some bad function of the smaller guy and polynomial function of the larger guy. If you think about this, it's really non-trivial. I mean, the brute force algorithm is like exponential in the larger graph to like guess the branch, that's how they are like behaving there. Okay, so this is like highly non-trivial result, but that means that if you have got some one tiny graph and one huge graph, checking if the tiny graph is in the huge graph, minor of the huge graph, is an operation that can be done in cubic time of the larger graph and some bad function of the small graph. But now if you think about the previous setting, we had got this graph class G and we had got this forbidden minus F, which were function of the graph class, and there's some finite list of some graphs. So you think of this graph class as something a constant, like graphs embeddable on a surface with 15 handles or some other your favorite minor closed graph class. Then there's this forbidden minors and they all have got like constant size. If you think about like recognition of the graphs embedded on a surface with 15 handles or recognition of the graphs that are in your favorite graph class. Okay. So what you have here is that if you have got fixed minor closed graph class, think like graphs embeddable of n surfaces with 15 handles, checking if a graph is in this graph, so if a graph is embeddable on a surface with 15 handles, this is done in polynomial time, like cubic time here, okay? Because what we do, you have got your surface with 15 handles, you have got your graph class of embeddable guys there, you have got a list of forbidden minors there, that's like a fixed list for this surface with 15 handles, and so you can check every one of them if it's a minor of the input graph, and if it's not, you know that's your embeddable. If one of them is, it's not embeddable. And you have got your test, which is like one of the topmost, if you think about one of the topmost like existential proofs of an existence of algorithm, because if you think about, okay, but if I want to implement it, what's the actual list of these forbidden minors? Well, this is actually quite a difficult question. I don't know the exact state there, but in general, I think it's not computable. You can list all the graphs and check if they're try to check if they're in graph class or something like that. But in general, I think it's not known how to know that the list finished. Maybe for bounded genus, it's okay. Maybe for bounded tree, I know it's okay that there's like an explicit bound how big these exclude minors are. But in general, this is like, you don't know how to list all these minors. So if somebody gives you a graph class and it gives you the list of forbidden minors, the algorithm for checking, I mean, these algorithm of Robertson Singer is reconstructible. So I mean, we know how it works. You're given H and G. But you don't really know how to get this list of minors. So this is like a very neat statement in theoretical computer science that says that for every minor closed graph class, there's a polynomial time algorithm that recognizes whether a graph in this graph class, but it's really hard to like really get this algorithm in hand because this list of forbidden minors is sometimes, I mean, I'm not easy to understand. We don't know how it looks there. Okay, that was like a highlight or like, so now the testing planarity you can do in linear time, and there are very different algorithms that do embedding, that just construct embeddings. I think we actually at some moment discussed some implementation with one of the master students, and I mean, there's like this, they look at cycles and try to decide what's inside the cycle, what's outside the cycle, and split the algorithm. So we can do test, you can test planarity in linear time, and significantly different than what you do here. You're just constructing the embedding and understanding how this embedding looks like. The first step in, I mean, let me just elaborate on it. I mean, the first step which helps is that if you have got a free connected graph, then there's a unique planar embedding. So you can deduce a lot how the things may look like on defining the algorithm. So you start with decomposing into free connected components and embed them one by one and then glue the things together. I think that's the good way of understanding how it should be done. Maybe in practice you can do it streamlined, but in my head, it's a good way of understanding that you're actually working with free connected graphs for planar testing, and the free connected cascade was so rigid planar embedding that you can deduce on the fly quite a lot about it. But it's a non-trivial thing. I mean, implementing it, it's quite a hassle. Okay, thanks. Let me go further. Okay, so before I go, let me make a suggestion. I think it never appeared. I think it appeared on some tutorials for a moment or something, but it never appeared in print on a slide. So I want to discuss also the relation of being a topological minor, which is like a weaker, no, less rich relation than being a minor. So it's harder to be a topological minor. So in a topological, remember that in minor relation, you can think of terms of operations, deleting edges, deleting vertices, or contracting edges, but you can also think of in terms of these models. So like if you want to embed H like in this graph inside a larger graph, then you really look at connected subgraphs corresponding to vertices. Yeah, and there needs to be an edges between these connected subgraphs. So this is a minor model, yeah? And in topological minor, you look for the model that looks a bit different. So if you want to embed this guy, so this is a minor, but if you want to be a topological minor, like every vertex here, like V, gets one vertex, not a blob. Okay, so this is W, here there's phi of W, and if this is X and Y, you get like phi of X, phi of X, phi of Y somewhere here. Okay, you get vertices, they're distinct. And now the edges become paths. So if this is an orange edge, it becomes a path. Okay, and if this is a gray edge, it becomes a path with these endpoints. Okay, and I mean, let me continue. Blue edge becomes a path here. I don't know, light blue becomes a path here. Some vertices, and I don't know, this one becomes a path here. Okay, so this is a topological minor. It's easy to see that being a topological minor implies being a minor because you can just, for this blob, you can eat parts of the path so that there's only an edge between them. Like a blob for a vertex becomes a vertex and parts of this path so that the things connect. So this is like easy to see that, so this is easy to see that, that being a topological minor implies being a minor. But in the other direction, I mean, you can, I mean, the other direction is also easy to see that this is a less rich relation. Like, for example, if you have got, I don't know, a K5, K5 is never a topological minor of a graph with maximum degree 3. Yeah? Because you, being a topological minor, if in K5, you need to map the guys to vertices of degree at least 4 so that these 4 paths can escape, okay, corresponding to edges. But in minor relation, if you have got a big cubic graph, if it's not planar, if it's like very complicated, not planar, it's usually easy to find the K5 minor there because you can construct a few guys and get a high degree vertex and then make a K5 out of it. Okay, so this is, I guess, in this degree thing is one of the significant differences in topological minor. And one other thing you can think about, I think I didn't put it yet on the tutorial, but maybe you can think about it, is that this relation has an infinite antichain. There exists an infinite antichain. It's not easy to construct. The example I presented you for subperiod relation doesn't work here. It's not easy. It is a bit of a hassle to construct one, but you're invited to think about it, how to construct an infinite antichain for the topological minor relation. Okay. But this is something we'll discuss in general graphs, but this is something we'll discuss in a moment in some restricted fashion. Okay. And so as I said, it's not a quasi-order on all graphs, and you're invited to think. And this is not a 1 minute exercise. You need to think a while, I think, to get a good example here. Okay. So this is the topological minor relation. And I wanted to introduce it because I need it for some definitions later, and sometimes it will be useful in the tutorials. Now I want to go back to the well quasi orders and make a proof, something which is, I think, called the Higman's lemma. The Higman's lemma formally is something slightly different, but it's essentially the same, like on the combinatorial level. But so if you look in the Wikipedia for Higman's lemma, it's something slightly different, but combinatorially is really the same statement. Okay, so this is like a lot of, I mean, we are doing some sort of like on the boundary of set theory now and orders. So we have got a number of strange symbols, but let's go over it. Okay, so I've got one quasi order. Think, I don't know, integers with comparison or something like that, but there will be other quasi orders used later. Okay. And now I want to produce larger quasi order from smaller quasi order. And now the observation is as follows. I mean, this is like a very, and this observation and the proof is like a very important part of the well quasi order theory. So this is like something like very useful in many applications. Okay, so I have got some set, and now I want to, with this relation there, now I want to produce larger quasi-order. One way of doing it, and we'll prove it in a moment, is to look at finite subsets. So I look at finite subsets, A and B. These are finite subsets of V. So as I said, any finite set gives a well quasi-order. So the well quasi-orders are interesting if the set you're ordering is infinite. So it's important to say that we are looking only at finite sets. And we say that these guys are actually comparable. So they're comparable with this like less omega superscript. If you can like embed A into B so that every guy gets embedded on the distinct larger guy. Yeah. So if this is set A, say there are 3 elements, and this is set B, there are 5 elements, then you can actually take and map every guy to a distinct guy here. Map every guy to a distinct guy here. Okay, such that you're mapping to a not smaller guy. Yes, you're mapping to a larger guy, not smaller guy. Okay, so this is the this is a B here from this picture. Yeah, so this is like one is smaller than the other. If you can put for every guy in the smaller one, match to a different guy on the larger one, such that you're matching to an equal or larger guy. Okay, equal or larger guy. Good. So this is this, I mean, this may be abstract, but it will be useful later. But maybe this is quite a natural way of lifting order, partial order to finite subsets. Okay, and good. So this is how I define it. Now let's, okay, now let's, now the lemma, now, okay, so this is the definition, and now the lemma says that if you started from well quasi-order, the other one is also well quasi-order, okay? So if you started from well quasi-order, this new guy is also well quasi-order, and if you think about it, the new one contains this, I mean, this thing contains this one as a suborder, yeah? Because if you look at one element subsets, so one element sets, singletons, the order of on the singletons here is exactly this order here. I mean, it's like, so one is a suborder of the other one. Okay, so we're already enriching, you're taking a larger set and ordering it. And the lemma says that if this has the well quasi order, so no infinite antichain, no strict decreasing subsequence, then you also cannot have one here. Okay, and this is important lemma, but the proof technique is also important. And the proof technique is something called minimal but sequence. Minimal but sequence. So this is like an order by contradiction. So we are assuming that there's actually an sequence here that doesn't contain a comparable pair as we want in world quasi order. So we are taking the original definition of the world quasi order. We take a sequence and we want to say that there's always a point out a pair of an earlier guy, not larger than, I mean, smaller or equal to the lighter guy. Okay. And so assume that there is a counterexample, that this is not a world quasi order. So we look at some, so we look at the sequences that are counterexamples. And we now want to look at the minimal ones in the following sets. So there are a lot of counterexamples. Okay, a lot of counterexamples, maybe a lot of counterexamples. Let's start, let's put at SX1 the guy such that there exists a minimal but sequence that starts with X1, but there doesn't exist a smaller. Okay, a smaller guy. So one of the things, because we are now using the fact that there's a world quasi order. Okay, so. Okay, so what does mean the quasi order? So let's look at all the sets. Let's look at all, let's look at, say, family A, which are all the guys in A, V that start about X starts a bad sequence. Okay, all the guys that can start the bad sequence. Okay, and I want to say that. Because this is a world quasi order, it contains a minimal element, an element that doesn't contain a smaller one. Yeah, because this is like a simple argument that, okay, if you so take any guy from A, is there a smaller guy? Take any X1 as any guy in A. Is there a smaller guy in A? Maybe there's X2, which is smaller in A. Okay, is there any smaller guy in A? Maybe there is. Okay, etc. And this needs to stop at some moment. You cannot have a strictly decreasing sequence infinite. In V, so at some moment you end at some xk such that in A is, there's no strictly smaller guy, there's no strictly smaller guy that can start the bad sequence. So take this guy as the first guy of your sequence. So now let's call it, I don't know, y1. Okay, so this is like a minimal guy that can start the bad sequence. And now you look at all the bad sequences that start with y1, and now look at y2. Now look at all the guys that can be after y1 in a bad sequence. Okay, so you start with your bad sequence y1, and now look at y2, which are the guys that can be after y1 in a bad sequence, and you again take a minimal one. Okay, so take a guy such that any smaller guy will never be a bad sequence. Okay, and again the same argument shows that there's always one minimal guy. So continue y2. Being the minimal guy, such that y1, y2 start a bad sequence. And you continue like that. Then you start look at the bad sequences starting with y1, y2, and choose y3 as the minimal guy that start the bad sequence. And you continue, okay? So, and yep, you continue and you end up with a bad sequence. I mean, the bad sequence is that you don't never have a pair of guys that the earlier guy is smaller or equal to the larger guy. And so at every step you never construct such a pair because you always have a prefix that starts a bad sequence. So in the end you constructed a bad sequence. And this is often called a minimal bad sequence. Yeah, that you always choose the minimal guy so that you still have a bad subsequence with the prefix that you started from. Okay. So you did this. Okay, and this is there's a comment that I realized that I was doing this argument, but yeah, so this is like I do it up there, but now I compared x-wise, but I wanted, yeah, sorry, I messed up things here. Okay, so because I mean, yeah, I realized that something's wrong. So let me wipe out this one. I did something very bad here. Sorry for that. There's a comment. I just realized exactly what Marcin Szanowski said on the comment that, but I'm now, okay, so this was a construction minimal but sequence, but I want to construct guys that are finite subsets now. And now I don't have this thing of choosing a minimal guys because I don't know that this is a world quasi order. But for the proof, now I want to choose like sets. So let's call them A1, A2, etc. So as how I do it, I choose A1 as the guys of smallest size, smallest possible size. So now my minimality will be the smallest size. Sorry for that. Now I want to look at the guys with the smallest size that start with the minimal bad sequence, start the bad sequence. Okay, so A1 is the smallest size such that there exists a bad sequence starting from A1. Okay. And then we choose A2 as the guy of smallest size, such that there's exists a minimal bad sequence starting from A1 and A2. Sorry for this mess up. I don't know what I was thinking really in the last 5 minutes. Okay, so you start with the smallest size that start with the with these two guys, and and then you look at A3 as the smallest guy that starts with A, so that there exists a minimal bad sequence, a bad sequence starting with A1, A2, and A3. Then you choose A4 as the smallest guy, that so that there exists a bad sequence starting A1, A2, A3, A4, etc. Okay, and by the same argument I said before, this is a bad sequence, what you constructed here, because the condition like AI is never smaller than AJ, the condition that you cannot have a smaller guy or equal earlier than the larger guy or equal, we're satisfied for every perfect, so we're satisfied in general. Okay, so we constructed this sequence. Good, sorry for that. And now what you do, you pick one element in every set. I mean, you cannot have an empty set. I mean, technically speaking, this set contains an empty set, but if you have an empty set at some moment, then all the later guys, I mean, then he's like smaller than all the later guys. So this is a contradiction. So all these guys are non-empty. So pick one guy inside everyone. So pick one side of one of them and define the sequence pi to be like ai minus this guy. Yeah, so we are deleting one guy. We're deleting one guy from every set. And now, well, these guys, okay, let's look at the sequence A1, A2, blah, 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 up there. Okay, let's look at the sequence A1, A2, A3. And these guys are elements of V. Now we are in the elements of V. Okay, now we are in the elements of V. So now we know that we are in a quasi-order. So we can use our previous lemma and choose a subsequence that's equal, like non-decreasing. Yeah? All the guys are equal or larger. Yeah. So there's AI1, smaller or equal AI2, smaller than equal AI3, etc. Okay, there's a red subsequence up there. Good. Okay, good. So there's a string increasing subsequence. So now let's make the following thing. Let's make the following gluing operation. Let's start with A1, A2, A3. Go to AI1 minus 1 and then write B's. BI1, BI2, BI3, etc. So what we are doing here, this is like the trick now. We're taking the sequence here, this is original sequence, up to the moment when this red subsequence started, and then we substitute BIJs. Then we substitute BIJs. Okay. And now we are using the minimality thing. We're using the minimality, like we started as here, but at some moment when we were choosing AI1, this was the smallest possible set that starts the bad sequence. Okay. And this guy is even smaller. This guy is even smaller. Which means that this sequence is not a bad sequence by the minimality condition. This is the moment when we use the minimality condition. This sequence is not bad. We are using now the minimality condition. What does it mean? That means that there's a pair, there's a comparable pair. I mean, there's a pair of like there's somebody earlier. Yeah, there's somebody, some there's some red connection here. So somebody early, somebody smaller or equal to somebody later in the sequence. Okay, where can it happen? Can it happen that this guy is smaller than this guy? Or smaller like with this less than omega superscript? Well, it cannot happen. This thing cannot happen because it would be a pair in the original sequence, which was bad. Okay, it also cannot happen like between 1a and 1b, okay? It also cannot happen like that, because if a, b, if a, I don't know, c is smaller, less than omega than some bij, okay? Then this one is of course smaller than aij. Yeah, because I mean, a missing element makes you a smaller set. Yeah, because you can always embed to the same guys up there. Okay, good. So you cannot have something like that. That's some A guy is smaller or equal to some B guy, because that means that this A guy will be smaller or equal than this A guy, which will contradict the fact that the original A sequence was a bad sequence. Okay. So what we have got, so what was left here, we have got that some Bij is smaller, less than omega, than some bik, okay? For j smaller than k. Okay, so we have got that some bi is smaller than another bi, but this is also a contradiction, because okay, there's an embedding of bij into bik, but you can extend it by taking aij, which is smaller than aik. Okay, yeah, which I mean, because this was as we put a non-decreasing subsequence, so aij is smaller than aik, so bij embeds into bik, and also aij can be mapped to aik, and we have got the, so from that we infer that, okay, I ran out of writing slide, but from that one we infer that aij is smaller this manner than aik, which is a contradiction. It's a contradiction with this original guy being the bad sequence. So we reached the contradiction, and sorry for the mess up at the beginning. I don't know. I mean, I somehow like did something, but I want like yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So this is the proof. I hope it was in the end clear. So we took we needed to this minimality to have some definition here. Here the minimality was like the cardinality minimality. We didn't look into this order, but look at the cardinality minimality here. We'll be looking also at some cardinality thing in the yet another argument here. We'll recommend today. Okay. So this is this one. This is sometimes called Hickman's lemma. Hickman's lemma is something like with the sequences that every sequence has got a that if you compare a subsequences of elements with being a subsequence, this is also a quasi-order, but it's like a very similar argument. Combinatorially it's really the same. Okay, but this is the statement that we'll be using in later today. Okay, so we have seen this lemma and we have seen the minimal but sequence argument, first screwed up and then the real one, but okay, let's take a step and so the main hero of today, and this is something that I want to argue in the next probably 20 minutes or maybe a bit more, is something which was Kruskal's theorem, which is like the very early, like the very early partial result on the graph of the on the Wagner's conjecture. Namely, you want to argue that, I mean, if you think about it, even arguing that trees are well quasi ordered by the minor relation, this is not easy. I mean, the theorem of Robertson-Seymour says that in general, the graphs are ordered by the minor relation, but even with the trees, it's not, it's quite non-obvious to prove it. And actually they're well quasi ordered by the topological minor relation, even if you root the trees and like require that the parent-child relation is satisfied. What does it mean now? Let's now understand what does it mean that rooted trees are well quasi-ordered with topological minor relation. Well, a rooted tree looks like that. So there's a root and there are some like children and other children and maybe some paths and maybe something else. And maybe you have got another guy that, I don't know, let me write here more things. Okay, and maybe you have got a red guy here that looks like that. And this guy has got a few children, and this guy has got the children with this guy. Okay, and now the topological minor here means that you can map every vertex to another vertex. So let me take, I will change the color to blue. Okay, that we can map. So for example, you can map this guy here. I know, map this guy to this guy, map this guy to this guy, and I think you understand about this guy to this guy, etc. Okay, okay, this might be, so you can map these vertices so that every path, I mean you may map this guy to this guy, yes, and every edge here, say this yellow edge becomes a path here, and the parent child, the ancestor, the standard relations behave, so you cannot swap something and go up instead of going down. So if an edge goes down, it corresponds to a path going down in the right. Okay, so this is the Podjeka minor relation, and additionally you're acquired on the, like, the parent child relation becomes an ancestor descendant relation later. Okay, so this is up there. So this is like a less rich relation than being a minor, and less rich relation than being a Podjeka minor, which means that it's even harder to be well quasi order, because in our all these graph relations, it's obvious that we don't have strictly decreasing sequences, because you run out of vertices, you're always losing some vertices on edge if you go to a strictly, but it's highly non-trivial that there's no infinite anti-chain. So if the relation is weaker and weaker, it's more and more difficult to have an infinite anti-chain. You can just look at the original definition for a quasi-order that, okay, if there's less and less relations, it's even harder in a sequence to find two guards that are comparable, and the earlier guy is the smaller guy or equal, okay? So this is like the thing with the So like restricting the relation more and more makes it more and more difficult to be well quasi order. And the Kruskal theorem says that even trees with the Podjeka minor and with being rooted are well quasi order. But even if you try to prove that being a minor they're well quasi order, it's still quite a non-trivial statement. But let's try to prove it. Okay, so let's take the minimal bad sequence, and here again we count the cardinality. So we take the number of vertices or the number of edges, I mean, it doesn't matter for trees. So you take T1 to be the smallest tree, that, so again, assume that there's a counterexample, there are bad sequences. So this is not a well quasi order, there are sequences that don't contain a good pair, and that, let's take T1 as the smallest tree in terms of number of vertices that starts a bad sequence. Then take T2 as the smallest tree, such that T1 and T2 start the bad sequence, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so you have got the trees. There's like where's tree, there's another tree. I mean, I don't want to draw it because exactly there's the sequence T1, T2, and T3. Okay, sorry. And now the point, now the trick now is like to try, because the natural way is to try to map root to the root. Sometimes not the good moment, but that's like the default first try, okay? Try to map root to the root and see what happens. So now we want to try to understand how does the subtrees map to subtrees, okay? And our tools, we'll have got in the proof two tools. The first tool will be saying that if you at some moment write the sequence T1, T2, T3, and stop at some tk minus one, and then start writing a subtrees, sk, sk plus one. These are the subtrees, so proper subtrees of tk. If you at some moment replace a tree with its proper subtree, this will be a good sequence. This is not a bad sequence by minimality, okay? This is our first tool, that if at some moment you replace a tree with its subtree, you have a good sequence, so there's somewhere a pair, and this pair cannot be here because that one ti cannot be a rooted topological minor of another tj, of later tj. It cannot be here because if you're a rooted minor of a subtree, you're a rooted minor of the topological minor of the entire tree. So it needs to be there. So the subtrees somehow compare with each other. So this is like one tool we have. We'll do it in, so this is the minimal thing. The other lemma, we have got the Higman lemma from the previous one, that if you know that some subtrees form a well quasi order, a finite subset of the subtrees also form a well quasi order, and we'll have got like, we'll be able to match subtrees to subtrees in this, like in when constructing topological minors, minor relation. Okay, that was vague, let's do it formally. But I wanted to point out which two tools we have. We have got the minimality of these subtrees, because when we can reason about proper subtrees about being in some relations, and then we can swap individual trees, subtrees into sets of subtrees by the Higman's lemma we had previously. So let's wipe it out. And let's wipe out what I just tried to draw here. We do it, we probably draw something very similar in a moment. So what I want to say is that I want to look at one of these trees, at all these trees, say this is tree TI. And now I want to remove the root. I'm removing the root and calling this family of trees, this family of trees here. So this is like one tree, second tree, and the third tree, this is FI. This family of like children, family of subtrees of the root after removal of the root. Okay. Now, the point is that we want now to look at not all the trees, but we want to look at all only the trees that are subtrees of the that are like the subtrees of TI minus root, that are like trees of TI minus root. Okay. So we're taking all these trees that were here. Okay, we're taking all these trees. Let's keep the colors as they were. So let's take the orange guy. We're taking all the trees. Okay, we are killing the roots. Killing the roots. And looking at the family of all the subtrees that are the remainder and call it F. Okay. And you want to say that this family, these are just some specific trees. I mean, not probably by far not all of them, but family of trees. And we want to say that these guys are all quasi-ordered. Why this is true? Well, let's write the sequence of them. Okay. Okay. So let's write a sequence. So let's write, okay. So let's write a sequence like S1, S2, S3, blah, blah, blah. This is a some sequence of elements of F. Okay, of elements of F. Okay. But all the subtrees, they come from some tree. So this guy is a subtree of some TI1. This subtree is a subtree of some TI2. This guy is a subtree of some TI3. Okay, good. So we have got these indices. Okay, so this may be like, I don't know, T7, T1, T17, etc. There. Okay, so there are some subtrees. So now we can pick up. Now we pick up a subsequence. Now we want to say, okay, let's look, but these indices are integers. So these indices are integers. And moreover, I mean, every tree have got only finite number of subtrees, okay? So unless some subtree appears twice in the subsequence, and this is of course fine, this is a good pair, there are two guys that are comparable with each other in the correct direction. So if one subtree appears twice in the subsequence, we are done. So assume that this doesn't happen. So every tree appears only finite number of times because it gives rise to only a few trees up there. So we can really find some subsequence, like call it A1, which is strictly smaller than AI2, which is strictly smaller than AI3, blah, blah. So we can find the subsequence of these indices that's strictly increasing, okay? Because they're like only, every guy appears only finitely many times, every sequence, every index. And this is like a sequence of integers when every integer appears only finitely many times. So there's a strictly increasing sequence there, okay? So yeah, so this is like actually like S, let's keep the colors. So now we're looking at SA1, SA2, which is just a subsequence of the original SA3, and this is a sub TIA1, TIA2, TIA3, and okay. So they are increasing. And now we do the trick that I announced on the earlier, that now we look at the sequence. So let's start with the sequence T1, T2, etc., and stop at this first guy here. So stop at TIA1 minus one, and then continue with SIA1, SA2, etc. Okay, so remember that that was part of TIA1. This was part of TIA2, etc. Okay, and these indices are like in this order. Okay, so you replace TIA1 with one of its subtree, Okay, so this is a good sequence. This is not bad. By the argument we have, so we had our minimal bad sequence, and at some moment we swap the tree of its proper subtree, so we cannot have a bad sequence. And now the argument now. Okay, so there's some relation here. This is not a bad sequence. And as we discussed, you cannot have this guy being a rooted topological minor of this guy, because that would contradict being T's being a bad sequence. You also cannot have a relation like that, because these guys are later. Yeah, you remember this order. So these guys are later guys. So if this thing here would be a rooted topological minor of this subtree, it would only, so if Tj would be like of Sac, but this guy sits in Tiac, and J is smaller than Iac by the construction, yeah? So we would have got a contradiction to T's being a bad C subsequence. So we really have, so we really, the only conclusion we can have is that some Sac is smaller than some Sad for C smaller than D, yeah? So we, it's the only conclusion, I'm smaller means that being a rooted topological minor out there. Okay, so we really have got what we wanted, that in this sequence, we really found the comparable pair in the correct direction. Okay, so we found a good pair, we found, we proved the claim by this argument, okay? And this is the way how we use the minimality here, yeah? That we are actually replacing the things with a subtree creates a, creates a good pair, creates a comparable pair with the correct direction. Okay, so we proved the first part that the subtrees are well quasi-ordered. And now, okay, so now we go to the next slide, I prepare the next slide. So we have got this claim here, yeah? And now we are going to use the Higmann's lemma from the previous slide. Okay, now we are using the Higmann's lemma from the previous slide. We're going to say, hey, if these guys are well quasi-ordered, then finite tuples of these guys are quasi-ordered, yeah? So we have got that, we have previous slide. Previous slide says that F with this embedding, with this is a well quasi-order. So this Higmann's lemma say that the finite sets of the subtrees with this thing. Yeah, and if you think about this, this is a very natural relation now, yeah? Because in the tree, in this trees, we had this rooted topological minor relation, and now we have got a family, finite family of trees here and finite family of trees here. And now this relation say that every tree here chooses a different tree here and embeds as a rooted topological minor, okay? So this is really like a being a rooted topological minor when every tree here is required to choose a different tree here to embed into. Okay, so this is quite a natural relation here. Okay, and now, so now let's look at the, let's look at like for every, so for every T, let's Ti, let's make a set Ai, which is just a Ti minus the root. Yeah, I mean, this is the natural finite set. You take the, this is the natural finite set. You take the true Ti, you kill the root, yeah, and it breaks into here three trees, and this is your set AI. Okay, this is your set AI, okay? And this is like a subset, this is a finite subset of F. This is a finite subset of F. So you can write the sequence, so by, if you write the sequence A1, A2, A3, up there, this is a sequence in this quasi order, which we know is well quasi order by the Higmann's lemma. Okay, so if you have got the finite subsets, there this is a well quasi order. So there exists I smaller than j, so that ai is smaller than aj, which is smaller with this omega. Okay, so I draw here already ai. So we have got later a guy. Okay, that I will draw here, so that if you kill the root, this is graph Tj, you get these guys, here four guys. Okay, and this is Aj, which should be orange here, because I used orange layer there. So this is Aj, okay, yeah. And you know that Ai embeds into Aj, yeah? So that means that you can take the blue color and this tree embeds here, this tree embeds here, I think I mentioned, and this tree say embeds here, okay? So you can actually take one tree and embed it into separate tree up there as a rooted topological minor. Okay, and now, I mean, it's pretty obvious what to do. You just extend this embedding by mapping root to the root. Okay, so we say that Ti actually is a rooted topological minor of Tj, because you map root to the root and you map the particular tree into the particular tree up there. Observe that here, I mean, this rooted topological minor relation, now we need to look for a moment to notice that actually this rooted topological minor is exactly the relation we wanted. Yeah, because maybe actually this thing here, let's change the color to gray. This gray thing is mapped here, but maybe the mapping actually maps this root here, okay? Lower, it's not necessarily mapped upwards, okay? So it maps here, but it's okay because now this edge in this root topological minor can be mapped this path. And because every tree in the AI chooses a different tree in AJ to embed into, these things are disjoint and this tree the root topological minor relation, okay? Good. So we have proved Kruskal's theorem. It wasn't, once we had all the tools, it wasn't that difficult. Yeah, so this is it. We had the contradiction. We have pointed out that there's actually a good pair in the T sequence, contradicting the fact that it was a bad sequence. So this is it. So we have proven we actually need to work for a bit moment to get there, yeah? I mean, we needed the Higman's lemma and we needed this operation of like minimal on the previous slide here of taking a minimal bad sequence and looking how it really goes, yeah? Good. So now I want to make an exercise here because I want to say one more sentence. I mean, I want to say one more claim, but I don't want to prove this claim in full because it would be super technical and super dense. And I really admittedly haven't thought through all the technical details of it, but I want to make an exercise. I want to make an exercise of how robust the statement here is, okay? Let's make a twist, which is not a very, like, just think of it as a, really an exercise, okay? Let's make a twist. Every vertex has a label, which is an integer. That's the important part. Every vertex has a label, which is an integer. And we require in the mapping, so it's not trees now, but trees with labels, integer labels on the vertices. And now we require that in the mapping, in this mapping, that if one tree is a topological minor of another tree, okay, so in this mapping, you will map like this guy here and this guy here and all this different there. You require also that the label here is smaller than the label here. Sorry, than the label here, okay? So there's some label here and there are some labels here and you require that you're only allowed to map to labels that are equal or larger, okay? So again, we added labels and we somehow make this topological minor relation is stricter. Yeah? If you put the trees with labels one everywhere, the same label everywhere, you will get the original thing. So you get something much richer. And now we want to say, is this still well quasi-order or have we just created an infinite check? Okay. And I think, unless I made a mistake again today, is that, hey, let's look at the previous proof and check, can we actually kick the previous proof? Where to kick this previous proof to actually prove that this is also well quasi-order? Okay, that you actually can have this. Okay, so let's go to the first slide here and let's make this. So again, we look at the minimal bad sequence and the point is that in this minimal bad sequence, I can assume that I take the minimal bad sequence and I want to add, so I will take a light blue color for additions. I want to add that the labels of the root of T1 is smaller or equal than the label of the root of T2, etc. Yeah. So, can I really do it? I cannot do it. That is here. No, I cannot refilter the minimal sequence of the root like that. Sorry. That was not the point I wanted to hear. So, in a sense, what you want to have here is that. You need, okay, now I got lost. Okay, so what I want to argue here now, okay, on high level, I want to argue here now that in a few places, you could actually add a few filtering steps that will actually help you handling these labels. Okay, so what I want to say here is that what's on, okay, sorry, I now I want no know what I want to say here. In this, on the slide, there's nothing about the labels that we did. I mean, everything works with the labels on the slide without any change. Yeah, I took the minimum bad sequence again, choosing the being smallest as like minimum number of vertices. And now these guys are all quasi-ordered, and we never used here really the structure here. Yeah, we took these guys, we took a sequence, took where it came from, we took the indices as the subsequence of the indices, and then we said, hey, I mean, this is still true that if you're a topological minor of a subtree or topological minor of the everything, because the mapping still stays the same. And this proof really works exactly the same, that you're just these guys are well quasi-ordered, so you use the Higman's lemma, because I mean just looks at the abstract well quasi-order. The problem now here is that I wanted to map AI to AJ, but I don't know what happens with the roots. I mean, maybe the roots that didn't comply with the labels. Okay, but here there's a simple twist. Okay, but this AI's this thing was Higman's lemma, so I not only have a comparable pair in a sequence of AIs, but I have got the whole sequence, whole non-decreasing sequence. Yeah, I have got AI1 smaller than AI2, I mean with less than infinity, smaller than AI3. I have got the entire subsequence, okay? And now I can look at the labels of the root, label of the root of TI1, label of the root of TI2, etc. Okay, so I can look at the labels up there, and there are some integers up there in this subsequence. And I can again, I mean, I have got this increased sequence, and now I look at these labels, and again, there will be a pair of labels because these are just integers, and integers are well quasi-ordered. These integers are, I can choose here like two labels that are smaller is area or equal than the later, or they're equal. Yeah, there's like you cannot have a strictly decreasing sequence of these labels up here. Okay, sorry, that was the place when I wanted to add. So adding these labels only adds here, like in a sense, adding one more step at the end, being really a proof that the product coordinate wise products of two well quasi orders is still well quasi ordered. There's nothing deeper in this proof up there. But you can like play with this proof up there more. And the statement I want to write in the end is that you can play with this more and adding this like labels, some annotations, and know a lot of things, and you can end up with the same statement proving that for every k, all the graphs with truth of g at most k are well quasi ordered by the minor relation. Okay, so you can actually end up with the statement by doing this annotation. You think of like graphs of bounded truth as like trees with a lot of annotations defining the graph on these trees, right? Rooted trees with a lot of annotations defining the trees. And if you do it, if you work hard with it, you end up with the statement that the graphs of bounded truth represented as these rooted trees with a lot of annotations, they were quasi ordered by something which is like less rich than the minor relations, so we can make the minor relations here. Okay, and this is the proof that's highly technical, and I wanted with these labels to somehow convince you that you have got the tools to prove it, but you really don't want to do it because it's like tedious and technical. Okay, so but for now I will prove, and we say that we know more or less how to prove that the graphs of bounded truth of from fixed bounded truth quasi-ordered by the minor relation. So this is like really like a statement saying that this graph class GK being this was well quasi-ordered. Okay? So if you have got a fixed bound on the truth, all these guys are well quasi-ordered by the minor relation. And this is generally a tool that in if you have got some class of graphs that you know they're well quasi-ordered by the minor relation, then like gluing them together in a tree, like the tree decomposition fashion, is still well quasi-ordered. But that's something we'll discuss next week, because that would be like important for this one. So I wanted to convince you in the end of this lecture that the graphs of bounded tree are well quasi-ordered by the minor relation. This is highly non-trivial. But inside there's nothing deeper than doing what we did for the Kruskal theorem, that like doing this type of arguments, but like iterating it a few times and doing some labels and producting with some other things. But like there's no more tools needed. It's just like you just need to use this hammer a few times and combine the proof out of it. And this is it, what I want to say today. Okay. Okay, I'm only 12 minutes left, so that's a good thing. Sorry for the mess up at some moment. And this is it. And next week, we'll have got quite a high-level lecture with a lot of details swept under the rug, when I will try to argue why, with the tools we have already seen, we may have hopes to prove the Robertson signal that there are no infinite entries in the minor relation. But this will be like quite, we'll be doing a lot of things with the thread, but I will try to convince you next week that there's actually some hope to prove such a statement with a lot of like tiny technical details to be still fixed. Okay, thanks. I'm stopping the recording and